During the long years of the First World War, Schoenberg worked on Die Jakobsleiter, Jacob's Ladder, and oratorio about modern humanity's crisis of faith. This bold mixture of Strindberg and Balzac, Swedenborg and biblical themes was conceived on an epic scale, 13 soloists, an orchestra of 250, and a chorus of 720. Die Jakobsleiter, which remained unfinished, is a work that stands at the convergence of a pre-war era, grandiose, richly textured, and open-ended, and the sobered perspectives, focused, acerbic, and tightly controlled, of post-war realities. The world was changing, and a generation who had tapped into the eruptive forces of artistic essences was now confronted with the task of taming and consolidating those same forces. At his desk in Mödling, near Vienna, Schoenberg wrestled with the consequences of his musical revolution. In tonality, all melodic and harmonic events can be related to a seven-note scale organized around a central pitch. Schoenberg's language of emancipated dissonance still lacked an analogous principle of overall organization. Schoenberg's solution, as simple as it was ingenious, resided within the very forces he had unleashed. Each piece was to be created from a specific ordering of the 12 pitches of the chromatic scale, called a 12-tone row. The melodic and harmonic dimensions of a work were thus derived from this Grundgestalt, or basic shape. To ensure the integrity of this 12-tone universe, no pitch was to be repeated until all the remaining 11 had been sounded. Each row of the 12 notes is like a shape floating in space. It remains the same, whether seen from the front or behind, from above or below. Thus a row. Can be reversed. Inverted. Or reversed and inverted. And any of these forms can be transposed up or down. They all remain the same row. Each 12-tone work has its own row. The row you just heard is from Schoenberg's Variations for Orchestra of 1929. Although you may recognize the row here in the cello line, Schoenberg would be appalled if you tried to follow his manipulation of those 12 notes. Just listen as you would to any theme, to what it has to say. Schoenberg, the inveterate tinkerer, sometimes created mathematical devices to help him work out the 12-tone relationships for each work. But Schoenberg's 12-tone works are anything but dry mathematical constructs. They are striking in the variety of color and mood, and continue to be indebted to classical ideas of rhythm, phrasing, gesture, and form. For Schoenberg, the 12-tone method was a means of liberation, not restriction, and he retained the right to break his own rules and to make his own aesthetic choices. He also saw no reason to suppose that atonality in the 12-tone method had made tonality obsolete, and in several later works he even returned to a tonal idiom. For Schoenberg, good music was not about method, but substance. He once told an interviewer, "I am somewhat sad that people talk so much of technical methods when it comes to my music. All music, all human work has a skeleton, a circulatory and nervous system. I wish that my music should be considered as an honest and intelligent person who is saying something he feels deeply and which is of significance to us all."